Hello, friends. We continue our study in the book of Hebrews. Remember that this is not a theological study. It is a devotion. So we're really trying to just encourage one another to see what we can learn about God, but also what we can learn about ourselves. So we're going on to devotion number 16. Would you turn with me to Hebrews chapter 9? And I'm going to read just a couple of things from verses 11 to the end of that chapter. And I want you to get into the habit of seeing what it says about God, what it says about people, and what it says to you and me today as well. And not all the time we'll be able to answer that question. Okay, so we're speaking now, the heading is the blood of Christ. If you look at the NIV Bible, the blood of Christ. It starts here by saying the priest entered into the holies of holies by sprinkling blood of animals. So he had to sprinkle blood of animals. He had to go through a ceremonial cleansing to go into the holies of holies. The holies of holies in the Bible and in the tabernacle is a place of God's presence. So the priest wanted to enter into the presence of God, but only could do that once a year. And then had to go through all the ceremonial cleansing and also the sprinkling of blood. But then it goes on to say and it's an outward thing. It's basically, if you had to touch a dead person, you had to go and sprinkle blood. You had to go for a sacrifice and blood had to be sprinkled and so on. So it had a lot to do with outward cleansing. But now Jesus comes with a different kinds of cleansing. And he enters, first of all, the presence of God. And he lives, but as a man, he enters the presence of God. And it's a permanent thing. It is not by the blood of an animal. It is by his own blood, the Bible says. All right? So, and this blood is amazing. It cleanses us. Listen to what it says in verse 14. How much more then will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself unblemished to God, cleanse our consciences from the acts that lead to death? Your conscience is cleansed, can be cleansed by the act of death, and so that we may serve the living God. So I think here's a significant difference. In the Old Testament, a lot of the ceremonial cleansing was outward. The priest could not clean us inwardly. But this priest, Melchizedek, the Lord Jesus Christ, comes and he cleans us inwardly. My conscience is clear before God. When I confess my sin, when I walk with Jesus, I have a clean conscience. And that is an amazing freedom, and the new covenant is so much better and so much greater than that. So he deals with sin that leads to death. This is what it says. All right? The priest could not deal in the Old Testament with sin that leads to death. But Jesus does. He deals with sin that leads to death. So in verse 15, it says, for this reason, Christ is the mediator of a new covenant, those who are called may receive the promise of the eternal inheritance. Can you see the big difference here? It's through Jesus, there is something eternal that he does for us. There is a cleansing inside that stops me from experiencing eternal death, but eternal life. And that is the beauty of it. Verse 22 and 23, it says here, in fact, the law requires that nearly everything be cleansed with blood, and without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. Significant. In the Old Testament, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. In the New Testament, the blood has been shed through Christ, and there is forgiveness of sin. All right? So then it says, it was necessary in verse 23, then for the copies of the heavenly thing to be purified with these sacrifices, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these. So the Old Testament is a copy of, and it's imperfect, of the New Testament, who is a better sacrifice, and it is a permanent one. In verse 20, so the Old Testament was a type where the New Testament is the real deal. Okay, you get it. Verse 25. Nor did he enter heaven to offer himself again and again. So the priest had to go into the holies of holies again and again annually to offer a sacrifice on behalf of the people. Jesus did not have to do that again and again. In fact, it says he did not have to go through the sacrifice again and again every year. He did it once. It is once and for all permanent. Just as a man destined once to die and after that to face judgment. He says at the end of the age, he's doing away with sin. He's cleansing sin. He's purifying sin. So that in the end, you and I will face judgment very different to the unbeliever. There's a lot of depth and significance in this chapter. It says, so Christ was sacrificed once to take away the sins of many people, and he will appear a second time, not to bear sin, but to bring salvation. So the first time he came and he bore our sins and he died for our sins. The second time, he is actually coming to bring the salvation. He is coming very differently. And that is what this passage is saying to you and me. The Old Testament, different. Blood, sacrifice. New Testament, blood, sacrifice. But once and for all, not a repeated sacrifice. And that is the beauty of what our Lord Jesus did for us, to give us a clear conscience before God. Thank you so much for that new covenant, Father. Thank you that we belong to a much better covenant. That we belong to a covenant where there's freedom, there's joy, there's a clear conscience, there's not all the rules and regulation of the old, but freedom in Christ in the new. We thank you for this day, and we want to live for your glory in Jesus' name. Amen.